Right, so the first thing in prepping your metal, it's helpful to have a basic understanding, very workshop working understanding of metal structure and how it behaves. So it's helpful to think of metal, it is a crystalline structure. So imagine it like little sugar crystals, so they're all packed together. In fact, if you take a piece of cast iron and you snap it, it looks a little bit like, you can see that crystalline structure. Some bronzes have that sort of grainy structure as well. You can actually see that crystal formation in the metal structure. So you've got this crystalline structure, and when you cast your metal, you're making an alloy. Those crystals tend to be fairly large because of the way they've cooled slowly in the mold and so forth. Because the crystals are large, there's large surface area between them. Those large surface areas is where metal can fracture and break. So stresses that build up while you're working the metal can travel between these large crystals. And if there's anything on the edge that allows a crack to develop, so you're putting pressure on the metal as you're rolling it, for example. So you've cast an ingot, you're going to roll it or hammer it out. You're putting pressure on the metal. If there's a little nick in the side of the metal, the pressure can build up there. And just like tectonic plates on the surface of the earth, they can suddenly shift and a crack starts. And it'll start between the crystals. And it follows the line of least resistance through the metal. And that's what causes failure in your ingot and when you're rolling it. There are other reasons for these cracks happening. It could be contaminants, it could be oxides, and these are, I mean, there are lots of little details that you'll pick up as we go along, and we have to mitigate against them when we're melting metal so that we eliminate the possibility of these flaws developing. So you've cast your ingot and you've got these large crystals, and now you want to work it. The way we deal with that initially is we have to break those crystals down. And we do that by forging. But before we forge, we've got to scalp the metal, which is to say you file off the outer surface, particularly the outer surface that was exposed to the air. So it's in a slab mold, it's the top, the little top bit of the loaf, if you like. In fact, we just normally cut that off or in the guillotine, slice it off, and that'll go in the next melt. Because that area cools slowly, and it's more open, and oxygen could have been absorbed, and so that's a weak spot. So we take that off. If it's an open ingot mold, for a bar, you've got a whole surface. So we file that off as well as we can to get it smooth. You won't get all of the pitting out that's in the surface if it's there. So when we forge it, we work so that that edge that was exposed is then a thin edge. So when you've rolled out your sheet or whatever it is, you can take that off. So it's all about making sure the surface of the metal doesn't have any potential cracks or fissures that could develop, which could then go through the crystals. So we've done that, we've prepped the outside surface, then we forge it. Forging breaks up the crystal structure and makes it finer. All right, so we do a round of forging. And then you, obviously, as the metal gets harder, the metal's getting more compact, and you're building up stresses, you have to relieve those stresses. And we do that, of course, by annealing. Annealing is a relatively simple procedure. You're just relieving the stresses in the metal. Think of it as a massage for the metal. The crystals will get a little bit bigger again, but they've been broken up. So they've broken up, and they will get a little bit bigger, but they'll never be as big as they were when they were cast. You can see as cast crystal structure very, very distinctly in some alloys, brasses, for example, compared to metal that's been worked. So by working it, you're making it stronger and tougher. Smaller grain structure means there's smaller surface areas between individual crystals, so there's less chance of big cracks propagating, right? So the further along in the process, the tougher the metal's becoming. Did you want to move?
No, I wanted you to talk just a little bit about why not to anneal too much.
Okay. So the aspect of annealing is accomplished by two factors. One is temperature and one is the length of time a temperature. So it's possible to anneal something at a lower temperature for a longer period of time, or most practically, we get to the correct temperature and do it very quickly. If you do it for too long at too high a temperature, the crystals will grow big, too big. And in fact, I've actually seen somebody anneal copper to the point where the metal actually became friable, which is quite some job. It actually overheated it so much in a very valiant attempt to make it as super soft as possible. Heated it up so hot, it was glowing orange, quenched it, and they went to forge it and it cracked, which is unheard of really with copper, because it is so tough and it's so malleable. But it just illustrates, if you make the grain growth too large, you're weakening and undoing what you've done, which is refining the grain structure. So it's very important to just get to the temperature, which is a dull red. It's just that moment where it's no longer just black, you've got a hint of color coming. That applies to most golds sterling silver. And in fact, I find it's pretty much the same with Shibuichi and Shakado and the traditional Japanese alloys.
Okay.
There's more specific things about some of those, but we're talking Goldsmith thing now. Yeah. And so the temperature needs to be minimal. Right, so you've quenched it, and then you've pickled it to remove the oxides from the surface, because you don't want to work those oxides into the surface. The next thing that a lot of people do, particularly people who are self-trained or so forth, is that they anneal far too often.
Right.
The mistaken belief is that if I anneal it or something, the metal is going to be much more malleable and soft and workable. And to an extent, that's true, but it also means the metal's weaker. And it's nowhere more evident when you're making wire, especially when you get down to very fine wire. Like if you're down, say, below a millimeter, half a millimeter diameter wire, if you kept annealing it, you've got a tiny little thread that has no internal strength. But on the other hand, if you've drawn it down 30%, say, and you're down to 0.5, and you think, oh, I'll anneal it now to make it super soft, the metal is so delicate, it'll just pull apart. Because you can, in fact, reduce most alloys down by at least 50%, in some cases more. I mean, and some of the alloys you can push down to 60, 65% reduction. So if you've got a millimeter, you can pull it down to 0.3 without annealing. And what's happening is the metal's getting stronger as you're going. Whereas had you annealed it too frequently, it's got weak. And this applies with sheet metal also. So oftentimes I see people annealing maybe from a cast ingot that's say 5 or 6 mils square down to a billet for a ring, and they'll anneal 3 or 4 times.
Sure.
And really you probably only need to anneal once, 2 at the very most. It's more efficient, takes less time, but also, most importantly, the metal is going to be in a better condition when you get to that point where you're going to make your ring. And your ring's going to be more robust, it's going to wear better. The whole internal structure of the metal is going to be, what should we say, optimized.
Sure.
And these are, you know, it seems like a simple thing. It's just a ring, it's just a piece of metal. But if somebody's going to be wearing something for 25 years, and you, as a professional goldsmith, don't know these things, it's a bit like baking bread that's like, well, it's edible, but it's actually pretty shit. You know, the difference between an artisan baker can make a wonderful loaf of bread that you think, oh my God, this is like eating clouds. And somebody makes a loaf of bread, you think, yeah, I could build houses with this stuff. And that's the difference. And it's these subtleties that are the foundational knowledge and awareness of our craft. And if you don't have those internalized, you're always going to be struggling. So that those ingots we've got now, the white gold that's cracking,
yeah.
I can look at it and go, okay, I think I understand what's gone wrong here, and there are ways to rectify that. But in the first instance, knowing all of what I've just been talking about means that as you go into making the ingot and processing it to the material that you can then make your ring from, you know that that material is sound, because you've understood and been aware of all of the minutiae of details and processes that are going on as you're working it and why you're doing it.
Mm.
That's really important.
Okay, so could I ask a question about the previously...
Only one of three, remember?
One of three. Previously, I thought that... So annealing was kind of almost resetting the metal structure.
Mm-hmm.
And that when you were... And like when you were hitting it, it's work hardening it. And what's causing the cracks was when it's really hard, trying to pull it apart, the small imperfections was pulling it apart. So when you're annealing it and rolling it, it was increasing and stretching out the cracks.
Yes, that is correct. And that is what's happening. You're building up stresses.
Mm.
Ultimately, when the stresses get too much, the metal will fail.
Right.
And it will crack and it will find the weak spot. If you're rolling metal, mm-hmm. all the pressure is one direction. So it's building up in the same direction. When you're forging, on the other hand, you're constantly changing where the blows go. Right. So you can get away with more with forging, actually, because you're redistributing the pressures. You put a bit of pressure here, and then you hammer on the other side, and you push it back. Whereas with rolling, of course, you're just stretching it out. Mm-hmm. That crack is getting bigger. Very careful forging. If you know there's a crack there, you can forge in such a way that you can keep that crack together.
Right.
So you're sort of working, massaging around it. But that's going further and understanding it. True. But yes, annealing is, to an extent, it's helpful to think of it as resetting it.
Right.
But you're not just resetting it. You're actually moving the metal into a more ideal state, a little bit more fibrous, if you like, because mm-hmm. those crystals are elongating.
Sure.
And so they elongate in the direction of your forging. And that obviously adds more strength. So if you've got lots of little grains, they could snap. But now if they're all long and they're interlocking, the metal's actually got some internal coherence and a bit more toughness. And of course, that's where toughness comes from, those kind of structures.
Sure.
Okay? Mm-hmm.